in the middle of the Deccan Plateau, would we have a city that is known for its pearl market? It's because of the links with the Asia-Pacific region, with the markets of the East and the markets of the West, and so on and so forth. So, you know, you don't have to be living by the sea to have maritime consciousness. You don't have to be living by the sea to have ocean consciousness. I find many of our speakers actually are from Kerala, and in this session also, we have at least three speakers from coastal India. And it is true that, you know, post-independence India has a Delhi-centric, land-centric view of even security, with the obsession with our border neighbors. And it's only in the recent past that there is growing what the organizers of this conference have called maritime consciousness. I attended recently a conference which was on ocean consciousness, and basically the same argument that we are increasingly being made aware of the seas. And it's, as I said, unfortunate that all of this is happening in the context of the global discussions about the Indo-Pacific. Because central to India's links with the waters around it, for centuries, has been trade. And India has had even pre-European trade links with the regions around it. And India was a maritime nation for centuries. We now have a lot of good books written. Sanjeev Sanyal, who's an economic advisor in the Ministry of Finance, has a very good book, a couple of good books on this. And there are several others which have been published. But the reason for me as an economist looking at this, the reason, an important reason for this decline in maritime consciousness and for our neglect of the kind of thinking of K.M. Panikkar is the fact that as a response to our more recent colonial history, when we saw the British and the Europeans coming from the sea and exploiting us through their maritime power, we became an inward-oriented economy. India's share of world trade was 2% at the time of independence and became 0.5% by the end of the 80s. It's only after 1991, as we liberalized trade, as we opened up, that the share has gone up. It actually went up all the way to 2% again, but in the recent past has gone down, and I think the latest numbers suggest we're around 1.5% or whatever. So it's this low economic engagement, more than anything else, that has, in my judgment, taken the focus away from maritime links. And in many ways, the return of maritime consciousness is also linked to our increasing economic engagement with ASEAN, the Lucas policy, the fact that countries to the east of India are today more important for us, including China, as economic partners, than countries to the west of India, which is up top, by which I mean Europe and North America. And on the other hand, energy, we have become acutely dependent. 90% of our energy needs are now met through imports, and therefore the energy links to West Asia, the trade links to East, and migration, a subject that doesn't always come up in conversations about, you know, both about economic globalization as well as international relations, that migration of Indians, people of Indian origin across this entire region has become an extremely important part of our links with the rest of the world. So given all of this, I think this conference has had some very interesting sessions on both the geopolitics, the geoeconomics, the history and the contemporary relevance of the maritime economy for India. And there is certainly much greater awareness today than even 10 years back, and certainly than 20, 30 years back. Against this background, we have a very distinguished panel. We begin with someone for whom I have had an enormous personal regard for many years, whom I've learned a lot from myself reading his essays, Admiral Raja Menon. Sir, I'm privileged to invite you to be the opening speaker. We are not getting connectivity at all. Yeah, please.
Yeah, how's that now?
Yeah, now it's better.
Yeah, I must confess that although I had read Panika, it was only when this conference was scheduled that I began to research him.
I think we are losing him. You have to adjust your links, I think. We have lost him. Shall I move on to Admiral Muralidharan?
Yes, so meanwhile, we can move on to the next speaker.
Yeah, Admiral Muralidharan, if you can take over before.
So, yeah, I'll do that. Can you hear me, Dr. Yeah, Baru?
Yes.
Okay. Dr. Sanjay Baru, my fellow panelists, at the outset, let me thank Ambassador Dr. Raghavan and team at ICWA for giving me the opportunity to be part of this very eminent panel. And I'm also a little nervous because my guru, Admiral Raja Menon, is in the panel. But let me take on by saying that, in my view, Sardar K.M. Panika was perhaps the first Indian strategist at the turn of independence to push for developing a maritime perspective to further our national interests. And when he said, and I quote, "So far as India is concerned, it should be remembered that the peninsular character of the country and the essential dependence of its trade on maritime traffic give the sea a preponderant influence on its destiny. The fact can never be overlooked that the economic life of India will be completely at the mercy of a power that controls the seas. Also, the security of India could be perpetually threatened." Now, his works such as Strategic Problems of Indian Ocean, India and Indian Ocean, India Through the Ages, Asia and Western Dominance, Survey of Indian History, and Geographical Factors in Indian History, put forth the need for India to develop a maritime vision beyond its continental outlook. Now, Panika's perspectives were based on a study of British dominance in the Indian Ocean and the rich and long legacy of Indian presence across the vast expanse of the Indian Ocean region and beyond. While he had referred to the works of Admiral Mahan, he was also perceptive enough to observe changes needed in Mahanian doctrines due to the emergence of air power when he spoke of how with the mastery of air, it is easier to control territorially vital seas. Now, at this juncture, let me say that the maritime outlook was not something new to India. It was evident in Kautilya's Arthashastra, compiled over 2 millennia ago. And Panika himself has referred to Kautilya and even to the earlier period of Manu. Manu in his code has provided for shipping and port dues. Arthashastra talks of a chief controller of shipping and ferries responsible for a variety of maritime activities, including welfare of sea traders, seamen, ensuring seaworthiness of ships, and tackling piracy. In fact, there's a chief controller of ports to look after port dues and customs. And the Mauryan Empire had a board of shipping headed by a minister to exclusively look after shipping-related activities. Now, somewhere in the early part of 20th century, we had another eminent historian, and I referred to Radha Kumud Mukherjee, who in 1912 had published a study on Indian shipping, a history of seaborne trade and maritime activity of Indians from the earliest times. In fact, his analysis was similar to that of Panika, but brought out half a century earlier. And let me quote a bit from him. He says that the early growth of our shipping and shipbuilding, coupled with the genius and energy of our merchants, the skill and daring of our seamen, enterprise of our colonists, and the zeal of our missionaries secured to India the command of the sea for ages and helped her to attain and long maintain a proud position as mistress of the eastern seas. He talks about the geographical position of India in the heart of the Orient, with Africa on the west, eastern archipelago and Australia on the east, and a connection with the vast mainland of Asia on the north, and a position of seaboard that extends over 4,000 miles. In fact, he said that India can be found to be an assemblage of most of these geographical conditions on which depends commercial development of a country. Of course, later in his study, he lamented the downfall of Indian shipping industry and shipping under colonial rule, and forcefully argued for revival of modernization and revival of the Indian shipping industry for our economic advancement. Now, writing as Mukherjee did when we were still firmly under the British rule and the Indian Ocean, as per Panikkar himself, was an area where the Great Britain sailed the seas as an absolute mistress, it possibly did not get significant attention. However, Panikkar's analytical writings in the 40s and 50s, coming as they did towards the end of World War II, end of the colonial era, and our own independence, came to influence the maritime consciousness in independent India. And in my view, more so the publication of the updated second edition of his book, India and the Indian Ocean, in 1951. Of course, it helped matters a lot that Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru shared a similar maritime worldview, which is evident from his speeches and writings. In fact, in April 55, at a Congress parliamentary party, Jawaharlal Nehru remarked as to how people in this great bulk of north of India are what might be said land-minded. They are not so conscious of the sea as people on the sea coast and on the south of India. On the defense of India, Nehru said, "We have to be equally conscious both of land and sea, apart from air, which is common to both. The whole conquest of India by the British, the French, the Portuguese, and all others came because we lost on sea. It is lack of this conception of sea power that has been our undoing in the past. For a country like India, sea is most important from defense point of view and obviously from trade point of view." Now, Panikkar, in his book, Geographical Factors in Indian History, had described India as a peninsula washed on its three sides by the Indian Ocean. She was, from the earliest period, a country with a dominant interest in on the sea. He also analyzed the impact of mountains and the north in the north and the oceanic waters on three sides. Later, he was emphatic that without a well-considered and effective naval policy, our position in the world will be weak, and our future is therefore closely bound with India's ability to develop as a naval power. Now, coming back to Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru, while sailing on board Indian naval ship Mysore in 1958. Incidentally, he had two other future prime ministers of India with him, Indira Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi. And Nehru observed, "And from this ship, I looked at India and thought of the country and its geographical situation. On three sides of it, there is sea, and on the fourth, high mountains. In a sense, our country may be said to be in the very lap of the oceans. In these circumstances, I pondered our close links with the sea and how sea has brought us together. From time immemorial, people of India had very intimate connections with the sea. They had trade with other countries and had also built ships. Later, the country became weak. Now that we are free, we have once again realized the importance of the sea. We cannot afford to be weak at sea," unquote. Now, was it the influence of Panikkar? Possibly, as the observations of Nehru very closely echoes that of Panikkar. Now, Panikkar had urged for development of India as a naval power and had assessed it to be feasible based on the elements enunciated by Admiral Mahan. He also talked of India needing to have a long-term and short-term policy in naval matters. In his view, the long-term objective should be to develop as a naval power capable of defending our interests and maintaining supremacy in the Indian Ocean region. However, he assessed that we would need about 20 to 25 years to develop the necessary scientific, technological, and industrial capabilities. Therefore, as a short-term measure, he talked of development of a balanced regional navy operating in our own area, that's the Arabian Sea, Bay of Bengal, and also capable of joint operational fleets of friendly nations at global level. He was very clear that navy is not for defense of land, but to secure control of the seas and to prevent enemy from approaching the coast or interfering in our trade and commerce. He also spoke of the impact on the maritime arena due to emergence of air power, and importantly, the need for a naval air arm as against merely having an air force. Of course, he also wrote about needing for development of overall development of maritime matters, mercantile marine, training institutions, types of vessels, shipbuilding, and so on. Now, Nehru endorsed similar views and wanted a balance between different types of forces. And he said, not all the land forces can protect us from sea attacks. The Air Force can protect us to some extent, but only to a very limited one just near our borders. The sea has no frontiers like the land. India, therefore, has to play an important role in the oceans surrounding her. I do not mean that we should presume control of these oceans. That's too big a task. But we should be strong enough to resist the control of any other power. He further opined that the defense of India and the development of our trade require a certain type of sea defense. And he spoke of the destroyer type, that small, fast-moving ships that can easily maneuver. These destroyers or frigates should be the main base of our Navy, he said. He added, and an aircraft carrier also is desirable, which is really a moving airstrip, can be sent anywhere, stationed anywhere, and its mere presence gives a strength to the Navy and to our defense position. It gives a certain command over the area where it can reach. Now, in my assessment as a practitioner of naval aspects, I would say that the analytical arguments of Panikkar and more or less the concurrent vision of the then Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru both had a role in the growth of India, a growth of maritime consciousness in India, and the development of our mercantile marine and the Indian Navy as a major maritime force. Now, the early naval planners, while working on long-term perspective plans, were also pragmatic to dovetail short-term plans to meet the immediate operational needs in keeping with our budget availability. Thus, from a virtually coastal force at the time of independence, we were able to grow into a carrier navy with an air arm by 1961. And while we did not initially have the industrial capabilities, by early 60s, we started construction of major warships, or as today's term to use, Atmanirbharta. We have come a long way since then, and today we are into construction of aircraft carriers and nuclear submarines. I would also like to say that we have overall developed a very balanced Navy, capable of operating well away from our own territory. And this morning, our young panelist was worried about whether we could do sea control. I would say that our forces are capable of doing both sea denial as well as sea control. And in keeping with the current Indo-Pacific concept, our forces are operating deep into furthest reaches of both these oceans. We also developed a maritime domain awareness. And also, we're participating in major exercises like Malabar. We are in keeping with what is emphasized by Panikkar of operating with major maritime forces. I would like to conclude by saying that the Panikkar's vision of creating a naval tradition in public and sustained interest in oceanic problems and a conviction that India's future of greatness lies in the sea is very evident today from the policy of SAGAR, or Security and Growth for All in the Region, initiated by government, and more importantly, the views expressed by Prime Minister Narendra Modi at the Shangri-La Dialogue in June 18, when he said, oceans had an important place in Indian thinking since pre-Vedic times. Indian Ocean has shaped much of our history. It now holds key to our future. The oceans carries 90% of India's trade and is also the lifeline of the global commerce. Our region has diverse cultures and different levels of prosperity. It now also bears ships of major powers. Both these raise concerns and stability. He went on to say that the world now looks at promise on the 21st century, because the destiny of the world will be deeply influenced by the course of developments in the Indo-Pacific region. I think it very clearly enunciates India's vision for an oceanic vision. I would stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Admiral Muralidharan. I will now invite Admiral Raja Menon. He is back with us. Sir, please go ahead.
You need to unmute yourself, please.
Have you unmuted yourself?
Yes, I'm now.
Yeah. I unmuted myself. Yeah. Sanjay, I'm told that there's some problem with my equipment. And if I switch off my video, you'll be able to hear me better. Is that all right?
Yes, that's all right, please. That's all right. Thank you.
Okay. I wanted to say that until this conference was scheduled, I hadn't read Spanica to the extent that I have now and realized what an intellectual giant he is. He wrote from 1920s to 1970s. And of course, his chief fame came from Asia and the Western conquest. But that book, which brought him the maximum kudos, raised a couple of contentious issues. One of them was that he was suggesting it was a state-sponsored Western march of civilization to take over Asia. Now, one can take two views on this. Either one believes that or one has doubts on that. I have both doubts and I am also partly convinced. If one read the recent books published on the East India Company by Dalrymple and Shashi Tharoor, one gets the impression that it was a multinational that actually conquered India. And after the fall of Delhi in 1803, it was the East India Company that was involved, but not the state. There is another issue that comes up, and that is, did we have a great maritime heritage? And if we did, how did the British conquer us so easily? You want to take a view on this. Either we did or we didn't. And where I was asked to give a speech on a subject of my own choice, and I chose the clash of technologies, the reason for the British conquest of India. And I read Punker a great deal, and I was convinced that our sea power, when we confronted the British, was in a very pathetic state. And for this, I ascribe five or six reasons. One of them is the size of ships. We built ships of about 150 tons, 250 tons, whereas the British were sailing in ships of 3,000 tons and 4,000 tons. And I investigated the reason for this and found
and lost him.
I think Menon is he is muted, sir. Menon, sir, you have to unmute yourself.
You have to unmute yourself again. You're muted.
Oh, it became muted by itself. Okay. Sorry, it became muted by itself.
So what is the size of ships?
Yeah, the reason for the thing. One was the the lack of engineering drawing. And I even went to Baipur and saw the ships being built there out of teak. And the master builder had the plan in his head. He was virtually illiterate. The second, of course, was that we failed to master star navigation. And that's a bit tragic because we had some of the greatest mathematicians in this country, including Aryabhatta and Brahmagupta. But unfortunately, these astronomers got sidetracked into astrology and failed to produce a star chart for the use of the mariner, who actually was a very low caste. And in fact, in most cases, he's at all. The third, of course, was that the instruments for navigation, like the sextant, which was invented in the 1670s and 1730s, didn't become available to the Indian mariner until the 20th century. The fourth was the absence of cannon making. Most continental historians ascribe the arrival of the cannon to Barber's arrival in 1526. But actually, it's Vasco da Gama that brought the cannon first to India. And this is again very tragic because in South India, we had some of the best bronze casters who cast huge, two broad structures, and casting canon is no different. But unfortunately, here again, caste intervened that temporal warrior would not stoop to casting bronze cannon. The last, of course, was the absence of hydrography. We didn't produce any charts. I mean, if you've seen the Dutch Leiden charts in 1683, you find that most of the world has been mapped by then. And we, our mariners had no charts until the 20th century. So, is there one overriding reason why we failed to have the kind of technology required to face up to the British? I would say yes, that there is. And that is the social weaknesses of Hindu society, which is divided into castes. And if you went to see, you asked your caste. I mean, I was amazed that when I was told this, and I investigated it myself in the Shastras, I found the actual sentence which said that certain kinds of professions will lose their caste, including that of those who go to sea. Now, Murali has quite rightly brought out Jawaharlal Nehru's work on the discovery of India. And he has said that there should have been a revival of sea consciousness. But before that, I'd just like to cover what happened during British India. I mean, if the British were great mariners, what happened to the British in Indian maritime legacy? And for that, I've got to blame the British commercial interests, which were frightened by the shipbuilding prowess of the Wadia shipbuilders, that in 1820, they commissioned a royal commission to decide whether India could afford an Indian Navy plus a British Navy. And they sadly came to the conclusion that only one Navy was necessary. And the Indian Navy was abolished in 1868. Now, that is the result why in 1947, whereas you had many army officers like Kariyappa, Timmaya, Srinagesh, Rajendra Singh, and so on, we had no naval officer. The senior most officer was the rank of a colonel. And the maritime defense of India was the responsibility of the Commander-in-Chief Far East Fleet in Singapore. So that is the reason why we started off on a very poor footing in 1947. And subsequently, I don't think we have done all that well. For that, I would like to find excuses, but I think the main reason for this is the difficulty of keeping integrated large multi-ethnic societies. Now, there have been three large multi-ethnic states in the world. One is the Soviet Union, the other Yugoslavia, and the third is India. The Soviet Union and Yugoslavia have collapsed. As far as India is concerned, we have spent something like 60% of
we lost you again. And this time you lost you fully. Looks like you're muted again.
No, he's back. Yeah.
Can you?
Yeah.
Oh, in another 2 minutes, if we can.
Yeah. I'll finish in 2 minutes. The clearance of Kashmir and so on. But even as late as last week, when the Quad was being thought about, I wrote a paper for the Naval Headquarters saying that the greatest legacy of Naval Headquarters would be if they are able to shift the theater of decision from the Himalayan border to the Indian Ocean, because the Army has, with 60% of the defense budget over 70 years, grown to 1.2 million men. It outnumbers the Chinese Army by 250,000. and they still can't stop the Chinese from committing aggression. And I suggested that the only way to stop the aggression is if we took the theater of decision to the Indian Ocean. And I'm happy to say that I'm finding traction in official circles. With that, I think I've finished my 12 minutes and I'll close.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you so much. Sorry about all this. But I think you've made some very interesting remarks for further research. Those young people listening to you, I think the whole technology issue is very, very important. The caste system, etc. And I'm sure there's some sociological, anthropological work which one should be looking at. I now invite Ambassador Biren Nanda to make his presentation. You have to unmute yourself.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Baru. And at the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Raghavan for inviting me for this seminar. In his essay on India and the Indian Ocean, The Influence of Sea Power on Indian History, Panikkar observes, India lost her independence, never lost her independence till she lost command of the sea in the first decade of the 16th century. Was Panikkar correct in asserting that the decline and fall of the Mughal Empire was related to its neglect of sea power? Panikkar observes, the Mughals neglected naval power and had to suffer the humiliation of their trade being interrupted and pilgrim traffic being harassed by the Portuguese off their coast. It was only when the Siddhis of Janjira offered their services against the growing Maratha power at sea that a fleet was organized on a reasonable scale. Unquote. During the 17th century, the Mughals made overtures to the Dutch and the English to contest Portuguese maritime dominance. The former conducted trade deeper in the hinterland and were dependent upon Mughal protection. This was the source of the Mughal Empire's leverage on the English. In 1685 AD, Sir Joshua Child, the governor of the East India Company, reacted to Mughal censure with open war. The conflict was known as Child's War and ended in a disaster for England. The English dominated the high seas, but the Mughals were stronger inshore. They destroyed English outposts in Bengal and captured Bombay. Surviving company officials were taken to Agra and had begged for the emperor's forgiveness. In 1700, the balance of sea power had still not tilted decisively in favor of the British. There is perhaps one overwhelming reason why the Mughals did not build an ocean-going naval fleet. It was not necessary for the empire's survival. Mahan described conditions when sea power is critical for self-preservation. When the sea borders or surrounds or separates a country into two or more parts, and when there is a requirement for the maintenance of overseas territory, the control of the sea becomes a vital necessity. The Mughals had no overseas colonies and for most of their history, no credible threat of invasion by sea. The Mughal Empire collapsed not because of a neglect of sea power, but because of its internal divisions and the continental threat from the northwest. The invasion by Nader Shah in 1738 dealt a body blow to the empire. Regional governors stopped sending tax revenue to the imperial court. There was no money to finance large imperial armies. What came up in its place was a decentralized, militarized society. The East India Company had a force of 2,900 sepoys at the time of the Battle of Plassey in 1757. Its force eventually grew to 195,000 men in the opening decades of the 19th century, twice the size of the English army at the time. The East India Company did not have the capacity to resource the logistics and wherewithal for the gigantic enterprise by sea. The conquest of India was achieved by bringing to bear overwhelming land power with Indian manpower, revenue and credit on a crumbling and increasingly fragmented adversary. What were Panikkar's unique insights into the strategic dimensions of maritime space in the Indian Ocean in the 20th century? Panikkar observed that Britain dominated the Indian Ocean between 1784 and the fall of Singapore in 1941. During the first half of the 20th century, sea power in the Indian Ocean was the preserve of the Royal Navy. The naval competition between the world powers in the interwar period encouraged Britain to establish a regional navy, the Royal Indian Navy, which grew into a potent force over time. However, for the defense of colonial India, the focus remained on the land frontier in the northwest of India. Panikkar argues, sea power can only conquer the sea and only the army can hold the land. But the advantage of naval power is that it can protect or disable lines of communication through the oceans. India would always be at the mercy of the power that controls the seas unless it has the capability to dominate the seas. Panikkar points to some unique features of the Indian Ocean. First, there is the Indian subcontinent which juts out into the sea for 1,000 kilometers. Second, there is the distribution of islands and archipelagos near its continental shores, Sri Lanka, Madagascar, Mauritius, India's island territories, Indigo Garcia. Third, on both sides of the ocean, there are narrow points of ingress and egress that are easily amenable to effective control. He said, if a steel ring can be created around India with air and naval bases at suitable points, and if within the area so ringed, a navy can be created strong enough to defend its home waters, then waters vital to India's security can be protected. How might we appraise Panikkar's assertion that the Indian Ocean is the key to India's security? In terms of its geography and its economy, the Indian subcontinent has always been an island, dependent for its prosperity on maritime trade with the rest of the world. Panikkar was right in emphasizing the importance of the maritime dimension of India's security. However, in doing so, he underplayed the continental threats. Today, the continental threats to India's security appear far more immediate, potent, and dangerous than do threats to India's maritime security. Perhaps it is inappropriate to frame the question as sea power versus land power. What is needed is a clarity of objectives and a proper balance between the two. It seems likely that India will have to shoulder the burden of her continental challenges on her own. In securing the Indian Ocean and advancing our maritime security, it does appear likely that there is a significant potential for cooperation with like-minded powers in the region. Taking into account India's capacity, Panikkar argued that such a policy to secure the Indian Ocean would only be possible with the close collaboration of Britain. Independent India, owing to its distrust of the strategic intentions of the former colonial power, did not cooperate with Britain as Panikkar suggested it should do. India rejected the power politics of the Cold War era because it perceived no national interest in the issue at stake. The policy of non-alignment allowed India to draw support from both Cold War camps. During the Cold War, India was consistently opposed to the emergence of a dominant external power in the Indian Ocean region. After the end of the Cold War, however, the interests of the United States, Japan, Australia, countries of Southeast Asia, and India have increasingly converged over time on the issue of peace and security in the Indian Ocean. This opened the prospects for ever closer cooperation and convergence on this issue in the future. In other respects, Panikkar was far ahead of his time. He anticipated the strategic importance of securing maritime space in the Indian Ocean in cooperation with its island nations. He anticipated the rise of China as a strategic player in the Indian Ocean. He observed the transformation of the Indian Ocean from a strategic extension, the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans, into a distinct strategic space vital to the security of India. India, with its unique peninsula jut and long coastline and the maritime space bounded by the two choke points at either end of the ocean, was, according to him, destined to play a pivotal role in the strategic future of the region. In that sense, he anticipated by decades the emergence of the Indo-Pacific as a geopolitical construct in policymaking. How did independent India fare in translating into reality the new maritime consciousness Panikkar wrote about? Panikkar wrote, while to other countries, the Indian Ocean was only one of the important oceanic areas, to India, it is a vital sea. India's unique maritime geography in the Indian Ocean should lend itself to a deep interest in exploiting the full potential of sea power. Indeed, India's long coastline, large EEZ, and dependence on the Indian Ocean for the conduct of its international trade and the consequent imperative to protect its locks make it absolutely necessary that this should be the case. Above all, it is only in the maritime domain that India has power projection capabilities. A week after independence, India's naval headquarters issued an outline plan for the reorganization and development of the Royal Indian Navy, which envisaged a navy structured around two light aircraft carrier task forces. The British did agree to sell a Majestic-class aircraft carrier, INS Vikrant, but rebuffed requests for submarines, which India eventually bought from the Soviet Union. Meanwhile, the Indian Navy took part in operations related to the integration of Junagadh in 1947, Operation Vijay for the integration of Goa in 1961, there were no naval operations connected with the 62 conflict, though one consequence of the 62 conflict was that the Navy share of the defense budget declined to 4% in 1964-65. During the 65 conflict, the Navy was restrained from conducting operations against Pakistan, perhaps because it remained on standby to respond to Sukarno's threat to take over the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. A second reason was the government's desire not to prolong the conflict even after the shelling of the Dwarka by the Pakistan Navy, to which the Indian Navy was not allowed to respond. During the 1971 war, the Navy carried out a series of daring missile attacks on Karachi and played a significant role in the East. During Rajiv Gandhi's term as Prime Minister, there was a high-profile acquisitions, including the SSN INS Chakra taken on lease from the Russia and a second aircraft carrier, the Virat. During this period, the Indian Navy ferried troops to thwart an attempted coup in the Maldives in 1988 and provided active support to the IPKF in Sri Lanka. The Indian Navy also conducted coercive maneuvering outside Karachi during the Kargil War in 1999 and during the standoff between India and Pakistan in 2001-2. The Indian Navy has emerged as an... Pardon?
10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Yeah, 10 minutes are over. Just my warning.
Okay. Another two. Thank you. The Indian Navy has emerged as a net security provider in the Indian Ocean region and has conducted anti-piracy patrols, HADR operations, and non-combatant evacuation operations. After 9/11, the Navy escorted U.S. ships through the Malacca Straits. In order to strengthen its military capacities and to promote cooperation with friendly navies, the Indian Navy regularly participates in multilateral and naval exercises and coordinated Navy patrols. However, despite all this, by and large, Navy military funding priorities have been continental in outlook, and the Indian Navy has consistently been the recipient of the smallest share of resources amongst the three services. In FY 2021, the Navy was allocated 15% of the defense budget. It would appear that despite the rise of maritime consciousness, the Indian Navy has been a victim of the continental challenges to India's security, which have consumed the mind space and wallets of India's defense planners. As we have moved from one continental threat to the another, leveraging sea power in the Indian Ocean has become a long. Thank you.
We now move to Professor Lawrence Prabhakar.
Thank you. I thank the Lord God for this opportunity to speak in this panel discussion. I thank Ambassador Raghavan and the ICW team for providing this opportunity in this panel discussion there. My presentation would basically look into K.M. Panikkar and the vistas of post-colonial India's maritime strategic success. If you could look into Panikkar's collective works, resemble and reflect what is called as post-colonial India's international relations based upon a confluence of geography, international relations and maritime consciousness. Panikkar was perhaps the one who really looked into the realist geopolitical matrices, and at the same time, he looked into constructivist identity factors in which he identified India in its political, cultural, social, and economic history to the colonial period, and then how this particular power would emerge in the post-colonial period to be a prison state in the Indian Ocean region there. Secondly, Panikkar's international relations and his maritime vision had an eclectic blend of how India's past geopolitics, cultural and economic factors of its maritime expansion, presence in the Malabar and the Coromandel coast, because we find that Panikkar writes extensively in terms of how India's outreach, maritime outreach, has been on the Malabar side, as well as in terms of how India connected with Southeast Asia in the pre-colonial times has been well exemplified in his writing there. And how the British Empire in India began to look into the same lens of locating India as a prison state of the Indian Ocean. Thirdly, Panikkar's views of the Pacific was more defined as he looked at some Japan and the United States. Even as the war was going on during the Second World War, Panikkar foresaw the entry of Japan and the United States from the Western Pacific into the Indian Ocean there. In retrospect, if you look into Panikkar's ideas of the Indian Ocean and the Pacific, they were the foundational aspects of what India has in terms of a contemporary post-colonial period there. Panikkar revised much of his views of the role of the British, who would play what is called the maritime defense of the Indian Ocean in the light of the East of Suez exit of the British in 1972. And then he began to have a more Indianized version of the naval defense of India with regard to the Indian Ocean there. In several aspects, we find that Panika was next to Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru in championing a new Asia and a new India that would be independent from the Western dominance and would carve out its identity as an Asian power of record. Cumulatively looking at this point, we find that Panika has been both a realist in international relations as well as a constructivist, in which he was able to carve out India's new identity in relation to both continental power as well as maritime power. The second important aspect of Panika's contribution in terms of his maritime consciousness is the development of maritime strategic culture of India. And that was Panika's central theme that he tries to bring in several aspects of India's maritime vistas, even as he explored in his various works there. One of the qualifications that makes Panika to be a maritime strategic thinker is the written works of Panika that basically elucidated maritime vistas in the Indian and Pacific Ocean and how he located India as a maritime power in these imaginations, and that he was able to do it in a more robust fashion, and how post-colonial maritime power of India would emerge is evident in his works, and that is what we find, whether it is India's Act East policy or India's Indo-Pacific or India's Project Mawsum, all these especially reflect in what was called Panika's imagination. Therefore, the vistas of maritime India and the consciousness was very much kindled and catalyzed by the very impressive constructive identity-focused writings of Sardar K.M. Panika. Having hailed from peninsular India, he had a very good understanding of maritime tradition, history, culture, and the outlook from the Western Malabar littorals of India. Panika envisioned that the emergent canvas of maritime geopolitics of India from the Indian Ocean from a levels of analysis perspective there. And Panika did examine the salient maritime legacy of civilizational India, and he worked in terms of the historical influence and impact of the Chola expedition into Southeast Asia. He envisioned how in the varying vistas of how post-colonial India would emerge and how India will play a predominant role, not only in the generic sense of Indian Ocean and the Asia-Pacific, in terms of the Pacific Ocean there. Let me highlight three important levels of analysis that are evident in Panika's maritime strategic thinking, and that from that we derive the operational considerations for India's maritime doctrine or India's maritime thinking. Firstly, Panika sought to derive the optimal post-colonial India's maritime legacy and the consciousness that came from the natural maritime theater endowments of India in the Arabian Sea, the Bay of Bengal, and the Indian Ocean there. He looked into both the littorals as well as in high seas access. Therefore, Panika combined in him a thinking of both Mahan and Corbett, in which he viewed the near seas or the littorals to be the defense area of India, which he looked into the steel fencing of what we could call the islands to be linked to India's defense, and at the same time looked into the optimum power that could come from India's outreach into the Indian Ocean and in the Pacific. Panika equated maritime power to national development, and therefore he looked in for the augmentation of a maritime culture and the consciousness of maritime perspectives of multiple perspectives of culture, knowledge, identity, and capabilities. Panika focused on these four aspects of culture, knowledge, identity, and capabilities. That would be the optimal exploitation in terms of how India would achieve maritime supremacy in the Indian Ocean region. Secondly, Panika looked into India's maritime consciousness and elucidation in terms of identity, culture, power, and capabilities, in which we find Panika looked into the derivation of this level of analysis in terms of the conscious imagery that he wanted to build of a prospective Indian Navy, as well as in terms of a Coast Guard that India looked into that. And therefore, we find, looking from the prism of the British Royal Navy's effective sea control and sea denial, Panika looked into these concepts to be Indianized in terms of how India will be able to effectively and customize these concepts of sea control and sea denial to its post-colonial circumstances. Therefore, we find that Panika was able to imaginatively look into these considerations. Although Panika was not a naval strategist, although he was not a maritime strategic thinker, but being a diplomat and a historian, Panika had the foresight to look into matters maritime in depth. Thirdly, we find that Panika's consistent paradigm of India and India's maritime heritage was well nurtured in his pedagogy, and how he tried to inculcate that to the Indian public, very particularly to the maritime, the mercantile context of consciousness. That he was able to embed in terms of the dominant aspects of sea power and sea trade as inseparable identities of India that will come in the post-independence period there. Panikkar not only wrote, but also spoke in different occasions and thereby inculcated this Indian public thinking, and that was the core causative as well as the catalytic factor of how India has emerged as a maritime power in what we could call in the present context there. Let me stop at this point and I'll, we could expect more discussions on these. Thank you.
Well, thank you. You did not finish your entire 12 minutes, so we get an extra few minutes. I think we will now play the recorded presentation of Professor Rila Mukherjee and then take questions and go forward. Dr. Pandey, if you can play the recorded presentation, please.
Good afternoon. This is the end of a long 2 days. I think we have all, I'm joining you firstly, I should make it clear that I'm joining you from Hyderabad.
Sorry, it's not, we can't hear.
Just a moment, we are playing. Good afternoon. This is the end of a long 2 days. I think we have all, I'm joining you firstly, I should make it clear that I'm joining you from Hyderabad. I think over 2 days, we have all looked at and spoken about K.M. Panikkar. So I don't propose to say so much about him as to address the issue of the growth of a maritime consciousness in India. And in fact, I would like to look at factors hindering the growth of a maritime consciousness in India. And here I'm going to talk about two historians who actually raise quite interesting issues about the archive on the historiography of the Indian Ocean that we have inherited. The first one I'm going to be quoting is Thomas Metcalfe. And this is a book called Imperial Connections. And this was in 2007. And I would quote him here that with the coming of the colonial era, Metcalfe says the historiography of the Indian Ocean fades away to almost nothing. And he says, it was as if a bustling sea full of vessels and people had suddenly been emptied and its waters rained away. As a mere British lake, the Indian Ocean no longer commanded the attention of historians. This shift in interest was partly a product of the archive. The records of the various European trading companies with their immense holdings made possible the writing of a richly textured history of the early modern Indian Ocean. But with the abolition of the companies, of the European companies in the years around 1800, this rich archive for the study of oceanic history came to an abrupt end. I'm still quoting Metcalfe. Not surprisingly, historians of the 19th century turned elsewhere, above all to the great land empire that made up the British Raj in India. Sailing ships and trading voyages were replaced in the archive and hence in the history books as well, by discussions of land revenue, property rights, and the organization of Indian society. So far as the ocean did engage historians, it was simply as an arena in which Britain demonstrated its imperial hegemony at the expense of millennia-old indigenous maritime activities that now faded away. And this is something we really need to ponder, because throughout the 20th century, the vast majority of works became increasingly land-centric, especially as regards India, and we completely neglected the coast. But there is another reason, possibly, for the nature of this colonial archive, which actually hinders the growth of a maritime consciousness in India. And this is this was pointed out by C.A. Bailey in his Information and Empire. And he says that the nature of the colonial state's information gathering in India, as against that of the imperial state in China, becomes focal in how the different strategies impacted on knowledge continuity. The heterogeneity of the Qing imperial elite led information to circulate in patterns distinct from those in colonial India. In addition to their loyal Manchu, Mongol, and Han bannermen, Qing rulers summoned to Beijing permanently or in regular rotation Chinese officials, Mongol princes, Tibetan Buddhist clerics, Eastern Turkestani beigs, and Jesuit missionaries. And this diverse elite was fragmented through different bureaucratic career tracks, social circles, languages, religious and cultural perspectives, and educational backgrounds. Information commonplace to one group might be unknown to another. And this was in contrast to the homogeneous circulation of information in British India. And Bailey suggests that an information order connected the colonial states with autonomous networks of social communicators in Indian society. And in this model, the most critical gaps in knowledge transmission were those separating the political intelligence sought by the ruling elite from the indigenous knowledge of its subjects. In Bailey's words, Indian rulers had access to rich information at the higher levels of government, but they rarely aspired to the density of surveillance systems which existed in Japan or in the central Chinese provinces. And Bailey wrote Information and Empire in 1996. Yes, so this is in fact before Metcalfe's imperial connections. Now, these two different takes on the colonial archive, which actually hinders the growth of maritime consciousness in India, does not really answer why Panikkar so early on could write, and Panikkar, I'm looking at his India and the Indian Ocean, an essay on the influence of sea power on Indian history, 1951. Panikkar could write that it is an obvious fact to any student of history that India's security lies on the Indian Ocean, that without a well-considered and effective naval policy, India's position in the world will be weak, dependent on others, and her freedom at the mercy of any country capable of controlling the Indian Ocean. India's future, therefore, is closely bound up with the strength she's able to develop gradually as a naval power. And here, Panikkar was actually quite consciously imitating Alfred Thayer Mahan's work of 1890. And when Panikkar was saying that a powerful navy was crucial to India's military and economic well-being, he was actually following Mahan, who had seen six factors affecting the power of nations. One was geographical position. The second factor was physical features, products, and climate. The third was territorial extent. Fourth was population. The fifth was the character of people. And six, the nature of government. And this is the book, Mahan's book also is called The Influence of Sea Power on History, but it has specific dates, 1660 to 1783. And this came out in 1890. Now, if we look at Mahan's six factors, which influences how a nation engages with the sea, one problem we do come across, and I would like to end with this point here, I'm not talking here of the colonial archive, I'm talking about the archives in the various Indian languages, regional literature, is, you know, there are references to the sea, there are references of overlordship, there are pretensions to control. But the problem is that the Indian state, as compared to the Chinese state, for example, was never a very meticulous record keeper. And in China, there was one single language, you know, which actually facilitated information being passed down from the imperial center all the way down to the provinces and the districts and the counties. But in India, to date, nobody has looked at the vernacular literature. They need not be geographical treatises. We did not really produce so many geographical treatises. But even the political philosophies of the various regional or coastal powers. And I think if we do that, we will be able to argue for a growth of a maritime consciousness in India, not just from 1800, but way, way back. And in fact, as many of the participants in this conference have written about, you know, of a maritime consciousness indeed from very, very early times. I think my allotted 10 minutes are up, so I shall say goodbye now. And I'm sorry, I will not be able to be there for the question and answer session of this panel discussion, but I hope that I have left you with some points to think about. Goodbye.
Excellent. I think, you know, I must first of all thank all the panelists for being so well behaved in terms of the management of time, so we have enough time for some question answers. Let me make some initial remarks and raise a couple of questions. See, it's interesting listening to historians, listening to naval strategists, listening to analysts of geopolitics, that, you know, we are critiquing the absence or the presence of a consciousness, of a maritime consciousness. But when I look at India today, to me what is clear is that over a long period of time, historically speaking, India was at the crossroads of Asia, both in terms of its land connectivity and in terms of its sea connectivity. Through the sea, it had links all the way to Vietnam and Indonesia and Africa and the Gulf and beyond. And through land, it had links all the way into Southeast Asia, into Thailand, Malaysia, Laos, Cambodia, China, and into Central Asia. And by links, I mean trade links, economic links, people links, movement of people. The fundamental change that has happened after 1947 is that this land connectivity has increasingly frozen. We are now faced with two adversarial nations which have virtually disrupted this land connectivity. So through Pakistan, through land directly controlled by China, which includes China, Tibet, and its allies, which is not allies, but countries which have been under the influence of China, like Myanmar, the land connectivity has been virtually disrupted. We have tried over the last 20 years through initiatives like BIMSTEC, Ganga, Mekong, ASEAN, Lucky's policy to somehow recover the links to the east. But for a variety of reasons, which we need not go into now, that recovery has remained limited. Land connectivity to northeastern India is limited, to Myanmar, to Thailand. So therefore, essentially, the land links that India has had, historic links, for several centuries, have been completely disrupted, which means the sea remains really the open door for India. So when I look at the structure of the Indian economy does not deal either through the movement of goods or, and this is something which we don't talk about often, the movement of people with its land neighbors. There is very little movement of people from India into Central Asia or Southeast Asia, East Asia through land. Look at where people of Indian origin are across the Indian Ocean. From Malaysia to Singapore to Australia to East Africa to Southern Africa to the Gulf, millions of Indians. And the trade links right from Southeast Asia to the Gulf, right across the Indian Ocean. So both trade and movement of people are through the seas. So I think one of our speakers referred to the India as an island. India is an island because the land links are virtually non-existent. And I do not see those land links being restored. Even energy comes through the sea. The hope that we'll have pipelines from Iran, pipelines from Turkmenistan, etc., remain a hope. The land connectivity that we thought would enable us to draw on energy from Central Asia and East West Asia are plans on paper. All the energy that comes to India comes through the sea. All the movement of people has been across sea. The trade is across the sea. So actually, we are an island economy linked to the rest of the world through the sea. So the question really I have for the panel is, why is it that we go on and on about a lack of maritime consciousness and reflected most acutely in the neglect of the Navy and investment in maritime power, when in fact our links with the world are through the sea? And the links with the world through the land have been denied to us by our two neighbors, hostile neighbors. And I do not see either of them reopening these links. I don't know whether Ambassador Raghavan is here, what he thinks of the prospect of India's links with Afghanistan and Central Asia through Pakistan being reopened. But I do not see that happening in the near future. I certainly do not see China being more open to our links with the through land with the rest of Asia. So we are a maritime economy in terms of our economic links. So the question really is, why is it that we are struggling with this whole challenge of maritime consciousness when the maritime links are so obvious? I now invite questions from the participants. Maybe the speakers can react to my comments. And then we'll see if there are any questions from the participants. So why don't I go in the order of our speakers? Admiral Menon, would you like to go first?
I'm just on mute. I think that the hijacking of the strategic discourse by territoriality. And even today, we have a defense minister from the agrarian north who says that our defense policy is not an inch of territory will be surrendered. Now, this has its history in the Kashmir War, the 1962 invasion of the Chinese, the 1965 attempt by Pakistan to take over Kashmir, and the Naga uprising, the Mizo uprising, the Maoist uprising. As a result of all this, New Delhi is tied up totally by territoriality. And let's face it, that when I was a young officer, the thing that was worrying most people was the Naga uprising. I remember losing my first batchmate to the Naga crisis in 1957, 58. So I think that the need to become a regional power has not struck our strategic thinkers loudly enough. We have no power projection. Power projection, as somebody in the panel quite rightly said, can only be done by the Navy. And I keep saying, numbers talk. 15% is a sad amount for a naval power. It indicates the absence of a maritime consciousness. But I'm being fair in the sense that I don't blame the leaders in Delhi so much, because they have been tied up with keeping a multi-ethnic society together, and they have therefore invested heavily in land power. That it's all very easy to say that look at France, look at Germany. The Treaty of Westphalia guaranteed the boundaries of countries in 1648. Why are we worrying about the boundaries of countries in 2021? But we are worried about the boundaries of countries in 2021. Maybe there is a boundary solution possible with China. I personally think there is. And we have not taken it. And as far as Pakistan is concerned, that's another story. But today the land forces keep saying we are facing a two-front war. I mean, who told them we are facing a two-front war? Nobody. They have assumed in the directive that they are facing a two-front war. As a result of which, as I said, we have an army that hugely outnumbers the Chinese army, because the army says that we face a two-front war. And that is the reason why our sea power has been dwarfed. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Let me bring in another admiral. I'm sure he will echo some of your thoughts.
Thank you, Chair. Actually, I fully agree with Admiral Rajamenon. Basically, our powers that be sitting in Delhi have become so tied up that I will not, 5 square kilometers of land, I will not give it up. Now, in fact, I didn't bring it up, but Ambassador Nanda brought it up. You know, at the time of after 9/11, the Americans did not have ships to escort their high-value cargo ships, including the nuclear boats which were passing through Malacca. And it was the Indian Navy that stepped in with our resources. Now, these are not facts that are known to people. Whereas we make so much of song and dance about, surgical strike, this strike, because all happened across the sea. How many of our people know about the kind of rescue we did in the Maldives, or he looked after, or similarly, how we went in and Sri Lanka, our force, our naval ships were deployed there to, when they had an uprising at that time. Now, therefore, to give, no finance not coming, whatever our planners have managed with scrounging what we have with the limited force we have. So, till the powers that be start thinking that, yes, Navy is a way to project power. Actually, Admiral Menon actually rightly put it. Now, we have done so much. Now, what happened in Kargil? Again, while the battle there was focused in the north, it was our naval forces, we had actually choked the area. I mean, I happened to be deployed in that area on a ship at that time. Now, these are things that are not known to people, not known to this, but so that is why nobody thinks, why should Navy need money? Where an army needs so much money. I'll stop here and then I
think. Ambassador Nanda.
You're muted, Ambassador. You're muted.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm on, I think. From a broader historical perspective, I'm really looking at 2,000 years of history. The Roman conquest of Egypt resulted in the establishment of the maritime Silk Road and the land route. Port became into disuse. Most of this time, from the up to say 13th or 16th century, there was no challenge, military challenge in the sense, except piracy and various other challenges, but no state challenge to the safety of the trade routes. So Indian traders were trading all the way up to Southeast Asia, and the Sung emperor had also given the Indian traders and the Srivijayan kings particularly rights, that in return for paying a tribute to the Sung emperor, they got the right to have tolls and maintain and have interport ports where trading exclusively took place. That was the source of Srivijayan wealth. Now, the first challenge, military challenge to this very harmonious ecosystem of trade comes with the Chola expedition. And though we extol the virtues of the Chola expedition, it had disastrous consequences, because the Chola expedition, actually the Cholas, their entire business model was to raid and loot, because they had a temple economy which consumed all the material resources of the kingdom, and the Cholas were then raiding the kings all the way up the Indian east coast, trying to get treasure from them, and they did the same against the Srivijaya kings. As a consequence of the Chola raids in Southeast Asia, you find that the Sung emperor withdraws tributary rights, and then the trading goes to the hands of becomes a direct trading between traders. The Chinese traders who trade directly with the Srivijayan traders, that is the beginning of the demise of Indian control over trade, and then the Arabs come into the picture. But the Arabs, fortunately, are only interested in maritime trade. They are not interested in creating an empire. The Mughals are not interested in trade at all, and then the Europeans come, who have got this principle of exclusivity. They believe that the oceans belong to only the colonial powers, and they don't belong to everybody. It's not a free good for everybody. So now what has happened in the contemporary period is that we are witnessing a similar kind of situation where we are seeing the militarization of the Indian Ocean. Now, there was a discussion on the development of the economy in the Indian Ocean and the migrations in the Indian Ocean, all taking around the Indian Ocean and not over land. That is, our connection to Central Asia is gone, but we've got Indians in the Gulf, we are trading with the Gulf, we are trading with Southeast Asia, we're trading with East Asia and Japan. I think this is the reason for this above all is that the littoral is where the world economy is going. The industrial wealth of the world economy, the shifting of the center of gravity of the world economy is to the littoral of the Indian Ocean and the seas of Southeast Asia. That is where increasingly the center of gravity of the world economy is shifting. And therefore, along with it, geopolitical threats are emerging, because the economic interest of great powers is increasing. And Chinese are now trying to capture some of the established bases on some of the islands which Panikkar spoke about, that where India should establish a ring around India. So it is natural that it is in the contemporary contestation, it is natural that the trade is wealth is concentrated around the littoral of the Indian Ocean. So the power politics and the geopolitics is also taking place in this region. There's nothing surprising about it.
Thank you. Professor Prabhakar.
Thank you, Chair. I think what India has missed and probably would continue to miss is that the economy is on the blue seas, and the blue economy is the future of how India will basically develop there. And this is basically the consequence of maritime globalization that has come out of the long way from the 1990s. So even as India continues to neglect this blue economy aspect and is still focused inwardly, you find that India will be losing its maritime consciousness. That is precisely what Panikkar was basically talking about there. The second important thing is ocean blindness that has been the part of the ruling dispensation. And this ocean blindness is further being complicated very much today, because we don't find anything very remarkable or transformative coming in terms of how India looks into the oceans there. Thirdly, the most important thing is the importance of joint doctrine there. In any configuration of armed forces, you need to have a joint doctrine. And in the joint doctrine, you need to have a lead player. And in the case of India, in the joint doctrine, we'll have the Navy as a lead player, because the Navy is not only the logistical arm, the Navy is also the power projection arm. The Navy is also what is called as a strike arm. The Air Force and the Army do have limitations there. If this revolution in thinking doesn't come into it, I think India will suffer from this ocean blindness and the neglect of the blue economy in the years to come. So blue economy is the word that will keep us going in the future.
Thank you. I think that, you know, I'm glad you referred to the blue economy. In fact, it was one of the points I written down in my remarks and I did not bring it up, but I'm glad you mentioned it, because I think there is now growing consciousness. I mean, there is a very good paper done out of the Niti Aayog, and there are a lot of papers coming out of the RIS. And also there is considerable investment. I'm told we are working with Japan now to develop the technologies. Japan has gone way ahead in developing new technologies for deep sea exploration, tapping deep sea resources. And I think blue economy is certainly going to be an extremely important factor that will shape ocean consciousness or maritime consciousness, investment in maritime security, etc. Because for a variety of reasons, more and more countries, and certainly including China, are tapping deep sea resources. And we need to develop the capability, the technological capability, and have the financial wherewithal to be able to tap into this. So I think I'm glad you brought up the issue of the blue economy, because going forward, in whatever the history and whatever the legacy of the past, going forward, this is going to be an important driver of investments in maritime capability and maritime consciousness. I was wondering whether I can draw in Dr. Raghavan into this discussion. I see him on my laptop. Do you see it?
He's there. I can also see him.
Yeah, you'll have to unmute yourself if you are willing to comment, or otherwise, any questions. I'll invite questions. I don't see any questions in the chat box. And we have about 10 minutes left for this session. So, are there any questions? Is anybody interested? I see TC has unmuted. Right. Are there no questions? A long day for everybody. Well, in which case, then let me make some summing up remarks and thank our panelists. I do think this is an extremely important subject. I would like to compliment ICWA, and I'd like to compliment Dr. Pandey and Dr. Raghavan and their colleagues for organizing this conference. We've had some very interesting presentations in the last 2 days. I've heard at least 4 or 5 of them, not all of them. I do think, I find it encouraging that we have a lot of young people working in this area. Many of the papers were presented by young researchers that suggest that there's a new generation of researchers in this area, and which is always promising. And as I said, I think going forward, our links, you know, I would like to believe that it's not simply the Indo-Pacific that is at the center of India's maritime consciousness and ocean consciousness. It's not about Quad. It's not about China. It's not about, you know, security. It's about the economy, because the India's links with the Gulf, the energy dependence India has across the Indian Ocean, the trade links that India has across the Indian Ocean, I mean, these are central to our national security, our national development. And it is those links that will continue to make the Indian Ocean and the Indo-Pacific region important for India, which is why I agree with both our admirals when they lament the inadequate investment in the Navy, in naval power, in the inadequate investment in aircraft carriers or submarines, the security infrastructure that we need in order to defend our economic interests. And our economic interests are going to grow. I am a pessimist when it comes to land connectivity. We've talked about the Ganga, Mekong, we've talked about, BIMSTEC and reaching out to our neighbors. We talked about the Turkmenistan and the Iran pipelines. But I'm a pessimist when it comes to land connectivity. I think, the naval strategists talk about sea denial. We are actually, our big challenge is land denial. It's the land denial that we are dealing with. And the land has been denied because we were integrated with the rest of the world through land. And given the land denial that is a reality, and I don't see that reality going away, it's the sea that is our link to the rest of the world, to trade, to movement of people, etc. And so I would think that going forward, conferences like this will become even more relevant as we continue to keep the focus on our maritime links to the outside world and the focus on the need to bolster these links, both through economic policies at home, through investment in the blue economy, an important subject that was brought up towards the end of our session, and through investments in our maritime capability. So let me thank all our panelists for their observations. And thank ICWF for inviting all of us to be here this evening. Thank you very much. Over to you, Dr. Pandey.
Thank you so much, sir, for chairing the panel discussion. And thank you to all the distinguished panelists for their remarks during the discussion. Now, as we come to this end of this two-day international conference, I am sure we can agree that we had some of very interesting thought-provoking presentations and very engaging discussions. Now, it is my pleasure to present a vote of thanks on behalf of the ICWA. I would like to thank DG ICWA, Dr. T.C. Raghavan, for his constant support and guidance in organizing this conference. I express my gratitude to all the eminent speakers and panelists for taking time out of their busy schedules to participate in the conference. I take this opportunity to thank the DDG, Mr. Soven Bagchi, and Joint Secretary, Ms. Nitin Kapoor Mahawar, for their support. I thank Director of Research, Dr. Nivedita Ray, and the entire research faculty of ICWA and the technical support, technical team for the smooth running of the program. With this, we come to an end of a very successful conference. Thank you, everyone, once again for joining us, and we hope to see you at our next events of ICWA. Thank you once again. Good evening.
Thank you.